what example we have taken corduroy fabric or pile fabrics, so that we can use lap up and down. Yes, I repeat, before using it, we need to take a buyer approval because the two sizes will look different. And in case showroom, some buyer don't prefer it. For example, I was working with Esprit once in time, and we used to take nap up and down for their garments. And later on, they said, you know, Saurav, we cannot approve nap up and down, because what is happening in the showroom when we are showcasing size 6 and size 8, so the colors are looking different, so we cannot use it. So we went back to nap one way based on this. Again, once we go nap, in case we try to analyze what is the efficiency between two, so nap either way will have maximum efficiency for the same style. Nap up and down will have little less efficiency, and nap one way will have the least efficiency in the same style with same constraint. So, but nap one way is the safest option. Nap up and down, there can be color variation, and nap either way has the maximum efficiency, but we can use only for certain kinds of fabric. So hope all the marker modes clear with nap up and down also, in which category we can use. This is very important concept, because everyone need to understand this patterns are placed on top of the lay. And once, because it's easy to visualize one piece, but when the 100 plies are cut and the outcome comes, and then we find to figure out, oh, this front is going ulta and the sleeve is going ulta or upside down, we cannot fix it. We go ahead. So this is in short how we make nap one way, nap either way, and nap up and down. So before making marker, everyone talk about marker efficiency and marker efficiency. We need to understand the constraint also, whether the based on fabric, what kind of marker mode we are using. Based on marker mode, then we can pressurize our, we need to understand it, okay, it's a nap one way marker. The marker efficiency will be this much only. So accordingly, we need to decide. Now, going with this, what are the splice marks? Now, let's see, take an example. What is the, there is one small exercise kind of thing shown at the bottom. Before going technically, what is a splice mark? Let's say, for example, we are trying to spread the marker length. The marker length is 10 meter. Let's, for example, from this point, the length is 10 meter, and we have to spread the layer of 10 meter. And the roll length is given here. So first roll, we have spread. The roll length was 100 meter. So what we did, we have spread 10 plies, and this roll ends, and we finished it. There's nothing. Second roll, which we got it, it is of 104 meter. It's possible, it's, equally possible. So what we'll play it, we will play, we will apply 10 plies, and after this, 4 meter of ply will come. And what we have to do for 4 meter of ply, we don't have any option because the 4 meter. So we have to keep 4 meter. Next slide, third roller, which came as a 88 meter. So first we have wasted 4 meter. Now we applied 10 meter, 10 meter, 8 plies we have applied. Now after that, the next roll came is of 88 meters. So what we have done, we applied, when we start spreading, we said 2 meters short. So we have to waste the whole 8 meter of fabric because it's not fitting with my marker. So I cannot, because I cannot have a one ply in which the front, these pieces are not, these patterns are not available for stitching. So to overcome this problem, what we have introduced is we have introduced the splice marks. So now why it is used? First length is, second point I was trying to explain, there is a roll change. Removal of loss. Let's, for example, the spreader is spreading the fabric. And after spreading the fabric for 0.5 meter, he found out there is a flaw which will come right in front of this. So I cannot spread it. So he has to cut this fabric. So the whole fabric will get wasted. In case that defect comes at the last, at the 9.5 meters, still the whole fabric will get wasted. So we don't have any solution. Or short length of fabric use. So in sab cheezo ko, to overcome all these things, what we do is we make the splice marks. Now what we do? The splice marks, there are two types of splice marks, which is called a straight line splicing. Let's, for example, in a pattern, while doing it, what they do it, they intentionally make an area when there is no overlap of patterns. So in case my fabric fault comes here, instead of going till the original points, I will cut fabric to this line. And then I will spread the next layer from this line. So the fabric wastage is less and I can use it. So this is called straight line splicing. But this is possible only and only when there is a line in which all the pattern pieces are butted together and there is no overlap. So this is called straight line splicing. But there are chances that there is no place like this, which can just have a straight line thing. So in that case, we need to have interlock splice. What is it? Let's, for example, there is an area that my fabric got finished here. Now, I cannot start spreading. My fabric got finished here. I cannot start spreading from this point because this pattern will not come. This will not come complete. So what I will do, I will do overlap for that area and then I will spread it. So the objective is the overlap is that all the pattern pieces of lay either should come from one lay or other lay. And instead of wasting the complete fabric, I am just wasting a small amount of fabric. So this is what we call interlock splice. This is a very interesting phenomenon as far as the fabric wastage is concerned. Once we use, for example, in our cases, what we used to do it, when we don't use splice marks, please mute yourself. When we are using splice marks, the end bits, for example, I have spread 100 meters. So end bits will be huge number of end bits which are there in case we are not using splice marks and our fabric wastage is more. But once you use splice marks, so our short fabrics are less and end bits are less. So our wastage is less and efficiency reduced. So splice mark is interesting concept. For that, the person who is making the marker should be aware of what are the splice marks. The same time, the person who is spreading the fabric need to understand what are the splice mark and how they can be used. So in this case, a spreader who is generally a 8th pass or maybe a 5th pass need to be trained what is the splice mark and how we have to use. And also the marker maker, you need to understand why I'm making the splice mark. So while marker making, when I was in planning or when we used to do the planning, we always used to give it the straight line, give options for straight line splicing because that is the easiest way of doing it. Interlock splicing has some difficulties. So it's an interesting concept as far as in case we apply logic, because the whole thing is about saving the fabric. In normal terms, what we are discussing right now, it sounds like just saving of 2 centimeters or 1 centimeter. But once we spread the whole order quantity of 50,000 pieces, the saving is very when we can convert that saving into monetary terms, it's a huge saving. So okay, so this is a splice mark. It's an interesting concept. Any question pertaining to splice marks from anyone?
Sir, hello. How this is taken care of in automatic cutting?
In automatic cutting, in which the spreading is automatic.
Hmm.
Yes,
so
same
is,
thing.
Splice marks taken care of?
The splice marks when they're in automatic spreading machines, when they are doing it, the auto spreader, because the auto spreaders, in case the cutting, what we are doing that it is done automatic. In this auto spreader, once you see, there is one person who holds the rack and he's spreading it. And he's watching the lay which is going on. So while spreading it, once he see the flow, he'll stop it. It is about when the role is getting changed, ma'am. So when the role is changing, the operator himself is changing the role. So once he's changing the role, he can see from where he has to start. So it is not, what your question is, you think that it's
but
automatic cutting.
But found the flaws in one piece only, while in a one spread, then how is it taken care of?
Sorry?
If he found the flaws in one layer itself, while spreading.
In one layer.
That one particular layer, not while changing the role, but in a one piece plot only while spreading. In one particular layer, if we found the fault, then how it is taken care of? In
okay. For example, let's for example, I'm we are spreading it.
सौरभ स्क्रीन पे ब्लैक आ रहा है
अभी ठीक है सर
हाँ अभी अभी पीपीटी नहीं दिखाई पड़ रहा अभी काफी ध्यान नाउ नाउ इट्स ओके नाउ इट्स ओके
मैम लेट्स फॉर एग्जांपल वी आर स्प्रेडिंग दैट ले एंड देयर इज अ फॉल्ट व्हिच कम्स हियर लेट्स फॉर एग्जांपल एट दिस पॉइंट सो इन दिस ले वंस वी आर स्प्रेडिंग दिस फॉल्ट कम्स सो वी विल कट द फैब्रिक हियर वी विल गो टू द इमीडिएट स्प्लाइस मार्क्स लेट्स फॉर एग्जांपल स्प्लाइस मार्क इज हियर फ्रॉम दिस पॉइंट वी विल अगेन स्टार्ट स्प्रेडिंग So this will overcome the problem. So whether we are doing it manually or with through automatic spreader, the spreader will just see the fault or in case there is a roll and he will can see it and then he can start from that point again. Okay. So it's not about cutting because after spreading, this care we are doing it at the time of our spreading not the cutting
when yes,
the
lay is understand that but if it oversize during spreading then it may create a wastage of fabric that's what I'm highlighting so if it is computerized cutting
yes so we have to go to the right point for example fault comes here and the splice marks is here so we have to waste that much fabric then we'll start okay so this is the splice marks Now, so these are the things for the marker. And then quality of marker. This depends on the accuracy, complete data, style, size, number, piece name, precise line, accurate and persistent, and consistent, fine and smooth line. Pieces not omitted, correct grain, and plain line path for cutting. So all these things we need to see in the marker making. Now marker making, I'll just skip this slide. It's not that important. That marker making is through manual and computerized. Computerized is as the manual marker making takes a lot of time. It's tedious. Apart from tedious, the problem generally happens is that some parts are omitted, or we need to make one change. To make one change, we have to do it again. Sometimes manual is done on top of the lay, so the spread of lay get disturbed, or we make it on from on a big pattern, so it's get disturbed. Also, we don't have the our memory of all the markers which are used in past. So these are some problems with the manual marker. It's time consuming, require great deal of space, subject to error of grain variations. Very difficult in case some point which is coming and there is a grain variation. It becomes difficult. Omission of pieces is biggest problem because in computerized we fit there are total 35 patterns in this style. So manual in case one small pieces lapel has been missed or some small portion has been missed, it creates a lot of problem later to cut that part. But in computerized that has been sorted out. So generally it's computerized way marker marking which is preferred everywhere. If computerized is not there, initially what we do it, we make a miniature marker in which we reduce the size of all the patterns and make it miniature how it looks. So pros and cons of computerized is easy to understand. It is accurate. It's provide greatest opportunity for manipulation because we can keep playing on this. We can keep improving it. For example, when we used to give quotation for costing, we used to see the marker and we used to give again, please work on this. Please work on this. If you can reduce by it, market efficiency can reach by 85%, we can confirm the costing. Reuse of previously made marker is possible. We have a grain alignment, which is perfect that we are very sure that there is no problem with grain alignment. Omission of pieces and automatic marker making is also there. Now, what we talk about, marker efficiency. Now, factors that affect the marker efficiency. Now, this is factors that everyone talks about. Sir, efficiency, please make efficiency higher. But we need to understand what are the constraints in making the marker more efficient. Let's, for example, first of the fabric characteristics. What is the repeat size? For example, the repeat size is how much? In case of strikes and stripes and checks, what is the repeat size? Generally, if the repeat size is higher and we need to match, let's, for example, in this picture, the pocket has been matched properly. So, and what are the matching requirement? Based on this, our efficiency will reduce. As obvious, if the repeat size is high and there are matching part, there are matching parts, there is matching required on more areas, then in case the matching required is elaborate for shoulder also, sleeve, from sleeve also, then efficiency will reduce. Also, fabric width. There is an optimum width for a particular style and the width variation. For example, there is a 54 inch width, 72 inch width. In case we have a fabric which is coming in different width, we cannot cut it. So for from supplier side, we need to get fabric in one particular width, because in case we place a 56 inch width on type of 54 inch width, the 2 inch fabric will get wasted. So we need to have a same width fabric. Now, what are the pattern pieces? The some styles, have a better efficiency or better what we say efficiency based on pattern. Let's, for example, this pattern, it is of chudidar. So there is no portion which is able to fit in this area. So in case that is this correction, we don't have any option, but the fabric wastage is huge. But in case the patterns are like this, which are fitting each other, then we can have a higher efficiency. Grain orientation. Now, grain orientation also plays. Everyone understands there is a cross grain, there is a straight grain and bias grain. But if the fabric as shown in this picture, in case we need to have a fabric which is particularly in this direction, the efficiency will reduce because all the pattern pieces I have to place in this direction. And once I play the pattern pieces in diagonal direction, the efficiency will reduce. So we need to understand whether it's a grain direction is changed, then we have to see the how we can do it. Fabric utilization standards, the basics, fabric is 90% to 97%, and fashion firms, it is 80% to 85%. So this is what we call about the fabric efficiency. What are the constraints we need to keep in mind and how it can impact our efficiency? Because let's find out fabric width. What we do in practical scenario, we make the marker in different width, 54 inch width, 56 inch, 58 inch width. And so all the fabric width, which will come from 54 inch width to 56 inch width, we will spread on a 54 inch width marker and 2 inch will be wasted. From 56 to 58 inch of fabric, whatever the rolls come between that width, we will cut them on a 56 inch width marker. And the fabric which is beyond this width will get wasted, because we can make the marker based on the smallest width in our lay. In case we have make the lay plan, the smallest width of fabric, we can use it in our case. So we'll move ahead. Any question on the as far as it is concerned about the marker efficiency and the marker efficiency and the factors which contribute to marker efficiency? Okay, in that case, we'll continue.
Sir, I need to understand splice method, which has overlapping.
Oh, you want to go? Want me to go back on a interlock splicing? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Now, let's, for example, let's take from this side. My the objective is. Now, first of all, we need to see the objective, what splice mark is doing before going to the slide. The fabric has been spread and at one point the fault comes. So I cannot continue the spread because there is will be the fabric has been cut and the there will be half pattern. So I cannot stitch it. So I need to make sure all the pattern pieces of that particular lay are fully cut. That is my important point. So all the pattern pieces are fully cut. That is my important point. So in case of a straight line splice mark that you understood, okay. In case there's a straight line splice mark here, so the 10 piece sleeve and 8 piece sleeve will come from this side and the 8 and 6 sleeve will come from that side. Now, what is happen if there is not straight line? Let's, for example, the fault comes here in center of this point. Okay. And we are trying to make a splice marks here. Now, I have spread till this point. Ma'am, the screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Let's, for example, I have spread till this point and this the fabric has finished. The roll has finished. So I have cut it here. Okay. Now, what I have to do, I have to overlap this point because now, because this 6 and 4, this these patterns are coming from this lay. Now, this 10 and 8, which is coming here, they will not come from the first lay. So to overcome that, I have to overlap this fabric till this point so that these two pieces also come fully from the next layer. Because from the first layer, they are not coming fully. So I need to make an overlap so that these pieces I will cut from one ply and the other piece I will take it from the other ply. So that is what we call it, it's called interlock splicing. So that we overlap certain pieces in case, because in case you understood the straight line splicing, in which because we make a straight line, so all the pattern pieces, some 50% pieces are coming from this side and 50% from coming from this side. So it's clear. But when there is an overlap of patterns like this, so this much overlap I will do for the splicing also, so that from one layer I'll get all the patterns and from other layers I will get all the patterns. I hope I answered your question, ma'am.
I don't get it. क्योंकि मुझे लग रहा है joint आएगा फिर उस वजह से वो कैसे दूर होगा?
Joint नहीं आएगा मैम. Joint बिल्कुल नहीं आएगा. Joint is not permissible. Joint तो हम कर ही नहीं सकते.
Your point then.
Joint नहीं आएगा मैम. Let's for example, I have spread this lay. ठीक है. Now there is a lay which is till this point. So these two portions are coming from the bottom layer. Let's, for example, I have spread this point and the fabric is finished. So I have cut it. So these two patterns, one the rectangle shape and this front body is coming from bottom layer. And now I have overlapped this point. So this, the top square is coming from the bottom layer. So there is no joint. Joint is not permissible. We cannot have joint in any of the patterns. That is very clear. Let's for example, right. This way, I'm spreading this point. The fabric roll got finished. So I've cut this point. Okay.
I want to know where is the overlapping. This red mark is overlapping. No?
Okay. Correct. This red line is overlapping. Okay. So this, for example, yes, I've spread the fabric. You got that, yes, point?
Then you are saying they will not come joint.
No.
As I can see, half of the pattern in between joint. Then how it is possible?
So, ma'am, I'll repeat. I'll spread the lay till this point. Okay. Now that, yes, right. Yes. And now I have cut the fabric. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So, and now.
Okay. Okay. I have, got okay, it.
Next
got
lay.
It. Now clear? I got it. Yes, sir. Yes.
So this is how we make the interlock splicing. So instead of wasting the complete fabric, for example, so we just make an interlock. So if possible, we need to have a straight line. If it is not possible, but again, as it took little time for you to understand what is splice mark, the person who is making the marker need to be very clear what is interlock splicing. Also at the same time, the person who is spreading the fabric, because that person need to make it overlap. Otherwise, he has done the mistake, the whole thing goes for a toss. So both needs to be on the same page, and the cutting manager also need to understand the complexity of what is splicing. Can we move ahead?
Yes, thank you.
Also, the factors which contribute to the marker efficiencies, they are easy to understand. Also, For example, I don't know how many of you are aware of at how many points the matching can happen. Okay, this blockade is it. The sleeves can get matched. Also, the back yoke and the collar on the cross grain, sometimes they also need to be matched. So it depends on what kind of mitering the buyer required. Based on that, we need to make an efficiency. And because they are not cutting straight away, we do the blocking of those patterns, and then we recut them to make it the complete mitering process. So this will this depends on the repeat size. We'll continue with the slides. Spreading, I will not tick too much right now because I want to go to the bundling and ticketing also. Spreading is the process of superimposing plies of material on tapel in manner in which permit these plies. Now again, all these things are going in a combination. What is the fabric mode? What kind of marker mode, and how we will spread it? These three things need to be combined together, and then we can apply wow, we'll cut it. First, we decide the fabric. What fabric, then what kind of garment we are cutting, then based on that we decide marker mode, and based on all these things, then we can decide how we'll do the spreading. The spreading mode also depends on the direction of fabric and direction of fabric nap. The direction of fabric face to face or face one way, we can do it face to face and face one way. Face-to-face is a continuous spreading, fastest, least costly, used for symmetrical non-directional. Because jab face-to-face karenge to niche wala layer ulta ho jata hai. It goes other way around, so it's difficult to manage. So we need to see whether it's permissible or not. Face one way, we'll go one direction, we'll cut it, then we'll go back, then we spread it, then we cut it, then go back. So this is called face one way, in which we call it, it's called deadheading. Because what we face one way when we spread it, what is happening is, let's for example, there's a marker. This is the marker face one way. We spread from this point, we go back, we'll spread till this point, then we cut the fabric. Then we have to go again back to this point, and then we again start spreading. Then we cut it. Again, we go back, we spread, and then we cut it. So while going back, we are not spreading the lay. So that movement without spreading the lay is called deadheading, because we come back without spreading. So this is slow process, but it is accurate. So this is called face one way. I should have kept the picture here only, so it's easy. So face one way. Again, we need to define whether we are designing the face of the fabric, then direction, whether it is a nap one way and nap up and down. So based on these two directions, the four with the combination, there are four combination of spreading is possible, whether it is face one way, nap one way, nap up and down, or face to face, nap one way, nap up and down. So there are four combination of spreading which are possible. There are some cases in which the fabric is directional and symmetrical, so we have to use marker mode as nap one way, spreading mode as face to face, or face one way or nap one way. So that is option which we can use. Directional fabric, asymmetrical, marker mode, we have to use nap one way, spreading mode, face one way, and nap one way. So these are based on the fabric. So we can take, what we used to do is we take all the fabrics available and we ask for this fabric, what is the spreading mode and what can be the marker mode. Non-directional symmetric, marker mode is nap either way, spreading mode face to face, nap either way. In this, nap either way is applicable, so nap one way is also applicable. But in case if nap either way is applicable and we are using nap one way, we are losing fabric. Other way around, if nap one way is applicable and we are using nap either way, there is a fabric fault which is going to happen. So we need to be very careful about deciding this. So if just as once the person who is making the marker, he need to be very clear about what kind of fabric we are doing, what kind of spreading mode, and then he can make the marker. in whole garment industry, which I feel is this marker making takes a lot of thought process and logic behind this, and very small error which can constitute to a big mistake and the whole lace goes for a toss. Now we'll come to the option of ticketing and shading, which is about making the numbers on all the plies. When all the plies are cut, what we do is we make the numbers on each ply. So for example, Dr. Chaudhary was teaching yesterday that the spread is of 100 plies. Now all the 100 plies on all the pieces, we will make the numbering. And this numbering is from 1 to 100 on all the pieces, from front size, back size, sleeve, pocket, any part. And that is what we call ticketing. So this is ticketing. Shading, or we call sometimes shading, is the process of marking or ticketing cut components for shad matching, precision and sequence identification with respect to cut component sequence in the spread. Now let's see this picture. We all come from garment industry and we know that the shade variation is bound to happen. We are trying to reduce it, but we need to find a way how to handle it. So these kind of shade variation, which in case this will not happen immediately. Let's, for example, this trouser which is shown, which will not happen. This will be after some length. So in case we'll not mark each and every ply with the number, and while stitching we are not doing it thing, these kind of problems will happen and there will be a lot of rejection. Also, we need to understand that maybe there is a buttonhole. So this portion is going for some other portion. Is the screen not visible?
It is visible, sir.
It's visible. Okay. So this portion, which is color variation, for example, this portion is called for buttonholing. Now, after coming from buttonhole, in case we are stitching it, we need to make sure it, even if it has gone for some other, it need to attach in the sequence. In case this portion has gone for some other portion, it need to come back, even if something we have seen the cases going for embroidery. So embroidery, they are going for out of the factory. Once they come back, they need to arrange in that sequence. So ticketing is important before doing it. So as soon as the lace are cut, what Chaudhary sir was teaching is the video audit. The same time, we need to make the numbers. So numbers are very important, otherwise we'll not able to do it. So this machine, which is visible, this is for ticketing machine. We do sequence. The person after doing it will make all the pattern piece number, all the things, and details will be clearly written, whether it's a right sleeve or left sleeve, because we have seen the problem. The embroidery needs to be done on the right sleeve. Instead of this, they have done in the left sleeve, and what needs to be done. We take the buyer approval and we give 5% discount. So ticketing is very important, because in normal heights, after the piece has been cut, there is a difference between a right sleeve and a left sleeve. But people are not able to differentiate in a normal eyes, or a, for example, who is doing the embroidery, he is not aware. So he need to be aware whether this is a right sleeve or left sleeve, and each and each panel need to be mentioned to be clearly visible, because that we do keep the top pattern top of that, but they just throw it sometimes. Now precaution, ticketing is very important. Now these things are not in theory. What I have seen in problem while ticketing is that sometimes they have done the ticketing, and what they have done, they have stitched it. Like for example, there is a collar. There are two layers of collar like this, and in which what they have done, they have left the ticket on the inner part. Now it cannot be removed. You have to remove it. You have to open it. So you need to be make sure whether you have to remove. Sometimes in case the patterns allows, we give a special place for each and everything where the ticketing will happen. Sometimes the ticketing person, my mistake, is doing the ticketing on an area where there is an embroidery. So the person who is doing embroidery has to remove all the tickets. So while he removes the tickets, he just throw it, and then numbering goes for a toss because he is not concerned. It's an outside vendor. The whole bundle went to some other factory or some other place for ticketing, and with this once it reaches there, and they have changed it. So it's very difficult to do it matching later. So we need to have fixed place of frequency. And the very interesting problem what I have seen is there was different operators. One operator was doing the tickling from top to bottom, and the other one was doing from bottom to top. So the whole only the middle layer, after that otherwise everything is not matching. So it's a difficult task. All the persons who are doing ticketing need to follow the same sequence, and some it's vary from person to person. I have done the survey also. Some people find it's comfortable from top to bottom, some find it's from bottom to top. It's like counting notes. Some counts from bottom to top, some count from, but in a factory we need to make a rule how we'll do it. Generally, we do it from top to bottom. Now, ticketing is clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Now we can using also the barcoding system in place of manual ticketing.
Correct, correct. I'll come to RFID because it's ticketing, then we'll come to RFID also. Now, after this is bundling. Now, how bundling? Bundling is the process of sorting and stacking with or without ties. Cut components for further processing. Now, this is easy to understand that they have to make a bundle. Now, how we make need to make a bundle, it depends on a lot of things. How we will make the bundles for pieces. Because after ticketing, we'll make a bundle and we'll give it to him. Now, the purpose of bundle tickets is to, for example, we make the bundles and then they will give a bundle tickets. First, we understand what is the bundle tickets. Now, from bundle tickets, what we can do it, we can just monitor the progress of each specific garments. Okay, bundle ticket hai, once we have done a cutting room and we have given bundle tickets. Now, whether the button ticket is in embroidery, whether that ticket is in finishing, so we can see that bundle ticket jo tha, where it is, so we can make the progress. Ensure that correct parts are assembled together, because bundles are and ticket number both helps to make the right parts are assembled together. Components compensate operators for their work on each garment. Now, in case, let's for example, I'm a piece wage worker. What is a piece wage worker? I will get the salary based on number of pieces I have stitched in a day. So what I do, once I complete my stitching, I'll take that part. There is a perforated thing. I'll cut that part and I'll keep the bundle for me. And then I can submit in HR later and they will give me money based on my how many things I have done it, how many pieces I have stitched. Used it initially, not nowadays. This kind of practice are not followed too much nowadays. But yes, they used to do. So they can calculate how much work I have done. Bundling. Each bundle receives a ticket that identifies the style number, the size, shade, list of operation for routing and piece rate for each operation. Even it is written in key, okay, mujhe ye join karna hai to iske liye, whether I will get it 45 paisa or I will get a 1 rupees or I will get 1.5 rupees. So it has been kept. Operator keeps a corresponding segment of bundle coupon for each bundle they complete. Whatever bundle I complete, I'll take this thing with me so that I can take the money. Bundle tickets are also known as work or pay control tickets because they control our paying method. Originates in either cutting department or other departments. It can be framed. Used for pay control, I have given this information. Can be used for unit flow as well as bundle for production system. Even if it is a unit flow, we still make tickets so that we can track it. Two major divisions. Now, this is related to the payroll.
हाँ खोले उससे तो नहीं हो गया यहाँ पे वो पता नहीं सर अब शायद तो तीन जगह पे लॉगिन कर सकते हैं एक साथ तुम्हारा ऐसा तो नहीं कि वो दो होता है दो या तीन जगह पे लॉगिन तीन जगह पे मैक्सिमम होता है शायद उसके बाद वो हट
दो तो ये दो दो हुआ ना
एक बार मैंने यहाँ से भी लॉगिन किया था ना सेमिनार
पादरी से
जी जी जी
Okay, sorry, thank you, sir. So continue. This is based on what is for a pay package. In case the operators who are doing piece wage, they need to get compensated for the work. So we take tickets. So either they give it to, they keep the bundle ticket themselves or they give it to their supervisors. So in case it is given to supervisor, each of the supervisor division contains serial number of entire bundle ticket, the name of subsection such as sleeve, collar, front, style name or number, cutting order number or spreading ticket number, the date the bundle was compiled in the cutting department, size amount. So all the information ki what operation someone has done and who has done it. So they can even, so this is required ki till the point, for example, in the finishing the problem comes. So from bundle ticket, we can identify which operator is not doing proper work. So because from bundle ticket, we can see, for example, this lapel making is being done by three operators. So who has done it? We can identify from this part, who has done it is we can identify from that number. Even if you have seen it, sometime we give number to quality checker also keep for this bundled ticket, for this operator you give number one, for number two and number three on watch care, so that we can identify who has taken this and who has done this part. Now bundling depends on the manufacturing process. Now there are different types of manufacturing process in the garment industry, whether we are doing a progressive bundle system or a make through system. So we need to design ki bundle kaise banana hai, how to make a bundle. Whether now in bundles, what we need to classify is what should be the size of the bundle, whether it's a 10 pieces, 20 pieces, 30 pieces, whether all the pieces of garments will be bundles or only the collars will be bundled separately, sleeves will be bundled separately. It depends on the...
Excuse me, sir.
Yes?
Sir, we cannot see the slide. There is a gray box on the slide.
Okay, maybe it's... Can please... Now it's visible?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So the bundling depends on manufacturing process. Now, what we call is item bundling or make-through system. What is, depending on this, this is older version in which one operator used to make the complete garment. So all the patterns, all the pieces of that particular garments are in that bundle. So we make the bundle of 5 pieces, 10 pieces, operator used to come and stitch it. So to make a bundle for that production system, so for what we do it, we attach all the pieces of this and then we make the bundles. Now we have a progressive bundle system. The progressive bundle system gets its name from the bundle of the garments that are moved sequentially from operation to operation, as seen in this picture. Now, bundle size can change the basics. So what we do it, we are not saying all the we'll make the bundles of 10-10 pieces or 5-5 pieces. So they are moved in accordance. So all the pieces in this, what I'm trying to explain, all the pieces of 10 pieces are tied together. The person who is doing the sleeve will open the sleeve, make the sleeve, and then will attach the sleeve and send it. Handling time is very high. Another system is progressive bundler assembly system. What is happening in this? So there are some different sections. There is one section for sleeve. There is one section for collar. There is one section for front. And then there is assembly section when everything will come together and they assemble it. So there are different sections. So the bundle is will made. The bundles will be made only for collar separate, sleeve separate, front separate, and then they will go. And again, because they will go in different section and then they will assembly. So we need to make the bundle based on what kind of production system we are following. And each production system, we are not dealing right now with the production system in this class. Each production system has its advantage and disadvantage. For example, handling time is more. Somewhere in some production system, the handling time is more. The WIP, the work in process is more, because in case there are 30 machines and each bundle size is of 10 pieces, we have 300 pieces flowing in the machine. So WIP increases and everyone is talking about WIP to be reduced. So these things, for example, we have bundle size of 300 and the problem comes. We are able to identify the problem once 300 pieces are stitched together. So there are different things which are related to the manufacturing system. So that is a separate theory altogether. But yes, we need to keep in mind how we make a bundle based on our system. We have a UPS system also. It is not UPS. Everyone just thinks that it is uninterrupted power supply. but it is unit production system in which the pieces just move in one way. For example, they are hanging from some overhead supplier rack. They go to operator. She finishes her work and someone is controlling from remote and then it moves to other location. So this is called UPS, in which we don't have to make bundles. We have to hang them in this. So in case our factory is following this system, we don't have to make bundle, but we have to hang them there. And then someone can use it. So bundling, it depends. It's important, but we need to see. We cannot, because I have always felt that students do ask, sir, which bundling system is the best? No, we cannot. We have to see which production system. And according to production system, we suit the bundling system. Then what is the size, optimum size, whether 5 pieces, 10 pieces, and it depends on the garment. I am making a blazer. I will not make the bundle more than 3-4 pieces, because otherwise the error and the lot of creasing problem will happen. I am making a round neck t-shirt. I can have a bundle of 20 pieces also. So optimum bundle size and type of bundling depends on the production system and the style. Last, as we'll come to the end of my presentation, is this RFID tags. RFID is radio frequency identification. Now, what is this tag? Now, this RFID tag uses radio waves to transmit digital information that has been encoded on RFID tag or label. So that information has been encoded on RFID tag or label. So it immediately emits it. So unlike barcodes, the store information does not have to be seen or read. So it will automatically transmit it. So have to someone scan it. It will keep emitting the information. While the data used in barcode is based on the UPC, the data in the RFID is used with the electronic product code. So this is how we, so for example, everyone is interested in what is the actual production status. So RFID will give you the information automatically. Now, application of RFID. It's not the RFID has been used in only in garment industry. It has been widely used all over. You have the tag and it will just monitor. For example, right now I was explaining that operator need to see the how many pieces he has done for his wage. Now, there's tag is there. He will just, that tag will emit the thing and it will showcase how many pieces he has stitched in the whole day. Even if that information will come and how many defective pieces he has stitched, that will also get. So we can monitor how many pieces are being stitched from one line, then how many pieces are stitched from other line. So RFID is important concept which is coming. In the next slide, we'll see the problems in the RFID tags also. So the applications of RFID are manufacturing, inventory control. Right now I was talking about the inventory. People have not analyzed that the inventory is becoming a huge problem for them because they were using a bundling system in 20 pieces or 30 pieces. The whole problems was hidden and inventory was huge. To control the inventory, the RFID gives you the actual inventory, how much inventory is in the factory and how much we are doing it, how much our money has been blocked. The warehousing, we can see the warehousing distribution from RFID tag. We can just distribute, okay, these pieces will go to warehouse number one, this will go to warehouse number two from distribution. Logistics also, it's easy to understand. And supply chain management. So this is a broad application of RFID today, which is beyond this topic of what we were concerned more of the RFID, how in the sewing line and garment line. So, but once these tags are done, they have a huge thing. Even for calculating right now, then things are coming in sustainability and carbon emission, carbon footprints. So RFID tags are used in calculating that also, which there's how much movement they have made and how much movement a piece has been done in the whole industry, that we can calculate with RFID also. Now, what are the problems, challenges to RFID? It's a high cost. Still the cost, the initially cost was very high. Now it is per piece RFID, which can start from around 20 rupees, can go to 200 rupees based on what are the information we want to look from RFID tags and their different suppliers. So in case company is moving from traditional bundle tickets to RFID tags, they need to consider that what is the cost involved. along with the cost involved, whether we'll come to the next point. So the cost involved. Second thing is the security and privacy issue concerned with RFID tag, because RFID tags, they don't require any kind of scanning for things. They will emit the details of whatever is stored can go. For example, I am buying some garments, and my information is being shared by it is being automatically transported. For example, some female is buying lingerie, you know, and they don't want to reveal what size they are buying it, but it has been transmitted to everyone. So there's a security issue with this RFID tags that they need to overcome. How we can, because it is emitting the information, it's like Bluetooth. Once we have started the Bluetooth, and Bluetooth asks for permission from our side whether it's connected or not, but RFID will not ask. Anyone have the information can take it. RFID attacks are that they change the information from RFID, and they use some information they tweet in the RFID, they twist. So these are also the concerns. Now compatibility. Let's, for example, we all work in some industry, and as soon as a new system has been launched, we need to see whether it is compatible with everything. Let's, for example, this seminar we are doing in MS Team. So we need to see on MS Team whether we can run the YouTube also, whether we can do it on laptop also, or mobile also. Chaudhary sir was just discussing how many I can log into the system. So right now, a factory which has all the systems set, in case they want to do the RFID, they need to see whether they have all the tools with them or not, whether to do the RFID. Also, at the same time, it needs to be compatible with the latest machinery, because nowadays RFID, when the tag is there, once you stitch it, there is a RFID thing which you just scan it there in the machine and send it. So there is no need to note down how many pieces have been made, what is everything through RFID. So I need to install not the only the cost of RFID, but to make the whole arrangement, I need to install all these things, whether it's compatible or not. So it's a huge investment. So big companies first need to decide how much is the cost involved, and then we can use it. Also, there is a lack of standardization of RFID. Different countries, they use different kinds of, because I'm not going into that detail, what kind of rays they emit. So based on that, there's a standard on what we use in RFID. So these are the challenges for RFID, but yes, all the researchers, all the research are saying that RFID is the thing which will come next thing, and everything will be replaced through RFID. Okay, thank you everyone. So I guess this is for my session. I tried to cover the cutting part and the bundling ticketing RFID apart from my side. Tomorrow also I have one session with you in which in the first slide I was trying about the cut order planning, how to cut. So tomorrow we will take the section in which how some numerical example, if you are interested, just keep your pen pencil handy with you, so that we can do some exercise also, because once I just show the solution, it will not solve any purpose. But yes, it will you will able to learn it better. So tomorrow I have a session at 11:30, I guess, so which will be of numerical exercise. So any questions related to my topic or production system on garment industry, anything which if I'm able to answer it, I will glad to answer it. So I have kept 15-20 minutes for the queries.
Sir, I have one to ask regarding ticketing. And my question is, suppose the spray has 15 layers and the marker menu contains 30 pieces. So all 1500 pattern pieces is to be ticketed, or we have to, we have to ticket, give ticketing to all 1500 pieces, pattern pieces, because my layer is of 50 layers and the marker menu contains, suppose, 30 pattern pieces. So in short, I'm getting 1500 pattern pieces, so all has to be ticketed.
all, everyone, each and every piece will be ticketed, because this, then only we can match it. Even okay. in the stack because, is of...
Because I have seen somewhere that they do ticketing to only top layer and then they just bundle it. That's what I have seen somewhere.
Yes, they do it. Once you are very confident there is no problem of shade variation, let's for example we are doing with a dope dyeing fabric. Why we are doing it? The objective of ticketing is to avoid shade variation. Now, in case your fabric is dope dyed, which is a polyester fabric, and you are very confident that there is no variation of shade, then ticketing is not important. Objective is, first we need to see the objective. If ticketing is not important, we'll not do it. For example, in I used to do it for we were making shirt for two styles. For one style, we stopped ticketing because there was no shade variation. For one style, we continued with the ticketing. But once we are, there is a problem of shade variation. What your question is, we need to ticket all the parts.
All the pieces. Yes. All the because patterns. If the lay contains high number of lies, then it is a time consuming job to tag
every piece. Madam,
I want to ask that instead that if we can sort our fabric for shade variation in a storeroom, is that okay?
Ma'am, we do segregate them for shade variation. Why? Before spreading, we do segregate, we make the shade blocks, we spread. Still, there is a shade variation after some point, which is once we stitch the garment, so it is visible.
Different.
If there is no shade variation, there is no requirement for ticketing. But that is a hypothetical thing. Vastvikta mein aisa nahi ho raha.
Is the same case for use of RFID also?
No, not for RFID, because RFID we are not using only for stitching, because RFID we are using for monitoring of production process also, because we are tracking it, how much pieces they have produced. So RFID has a broad area, it's just not color matching. RFID we are using because we count, because now the production update, even the RFID is collected with some mobile app, and I get the data complete ki how many pieces are stitched in my line number one. So RFID has a broad applications.
I mean, for that also we have to give the RFID to tag to each and every part, right? For
only on bundle.
Only on bundle, okay, fine.
Bundle tickets. The bundle tickets. But bundle tickets have information how many pieces are in that bundle.
No, but RFID would eliminate the bundle ticketing, right?
Yes.
Any more question for Mr. Chaturvedi, Saurabh? Any more questions? Have any questions for Saurabh?
No, sir. It was very informative and beneficial for us. Thank you so much.
Hello.
So I'm really Hello. Thankful to Mr. Saurabh Chaturvedi for very nice and interesting presentation on this bundling, ticketing, and especially this spreading technology of spreading and technology of laying, and also providing the in detail knowledge and idea about this marking and planning. So thank you, Mr. Saurabh, for your cooperation and also for your nice presentation. Thank you, Dr. Mr. Saurabh.
Thank you, sir.